Right. Welcome, church. Some of those out there may have noticed that I did not say welcome to church. I said welcome, church, because you are the church. Right. You know, when you're little, and well, let me tell you just a story from what happened to me. My dad was over the road truck driver, and he'd been gone for days on end. He'd come home and he tried to sneak in the house, but his toes made this weird cracking noise, so it didn't work. So he's like, he's coming. But I'd jump around from around the corner, and there's my daddy. He's 6'5", and an inch taller than I am now. When I was little, that's way up there. And, you know, he'd pick me up, and he picked me up, and it just seemed like I was going out forever, never, never, and he pulled me. And it's a great feeling to just know that your father loves you. And how much more does our father, who is there all the time, all the time, when we reach up and we say, Daddy! You know, kids do that, Daddy, pick me up. And you can't resist a kid who jumps up and down and says, Daddy! And they're doing their own dance in front of you. Come on, pick me up. Well, how much more does God, when we just dance in front of him and say, God, we love you. If you haven't gone anywhere, you're not over the road truck driver. God is here with us all the time. Praise God. And he loves us. And we're tonight to show our love back to God and to all together do this. And of course, when we're all gathered together, God is in the midst of us. So as we raise our voices up to God, just picture God just raising, reaching his hands out to you, giving you just a big embrace and saying, I love you. There's a place where I love to run and play. You can't dance if you're sitting down. Yeah. You can, but it's a little different. There's a place where I sing you songs and praise. Dancing with my Father God in fields of grace. Dancing with my Father. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. are so many things. A healer, a provider, our strength. Oh, your name is amazing. Father, we ask that you would open our hearts tonight and our ears so we can hear your word, Father. Change us. Help us to become more like Jesus.
Hallelujah. Yes, Lord.
Father, help us shine the light in Northport.
Thank you, Lord.
Help us to remember you in everything we do. We thank you for everything that you do for us. And we just love you and praise you. We ask this in Jesus' powerful name.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Adore one another. Turn around, greet somebody, give them a big hug, and say hello. What I want to do is give you an opportunity to get a little taste of what we're going to kick off 2014 with a new series, and so we're going to play that video. The validity of God's word, the atonement, the Holy Spirit, eternal security, God's sovereignty, the whole deal, I tell you. And this is what we're going to do. We're going to have fun doing it. And so because we're going to have football season, every week, for those who have the courage to do so, come in your favorite football jersey.
I can do that.
Yeah, I can do that too. So we're going to have some great fun. Listen, let me just tell you that it is an absolute honor for me to be here and have this opportunity to share, and you invited me into your life by coming and actually taking some time out. But I want us to know that one of the heartbeats here at New Hope is that our heart and our passion is to be able to provide every man, woman, and child with multiple opportunities to hear, see, and respond to the gospel of Jesus Christ and not have to go anywhere. And this is what we realized when we started to talk about that. That it's an impossible task for us outside of God. And we also realized that we're not alone in the city. That there is a larger body of Christ that we're in partnership with. But we also realized that we need to be partnering with our community by the grace of God. And Thanksgiving was one of those great opportunities, and we partnered with many businesses and civic organizations and other churches, and we all kind of came out to be able to meet a special need in our city. And it's just a wonderful, just beautiful picture of that. throughout this particular series, every week we've invited a nonprofit civic organization to come who's doing and having a wonderful impact in our city and in the surrounding area. And we wanted them to come and share, give us a little presentation about what they're doing so we can partner with them and be able to be a blessing to them. That people of faith should be people of action. And this is just a wonderful time. And so I'm going to invite Sue to come. And she is probably blown away by our service, and that's okay.
Oh, she's beautiful.
All right, thank you, Sue.
Thank you, and I am amazed. It was beautiful, amazing. I wanted to thank, because the pastor Eddie said, no, he's got to call him just Eddie. So I want to thank Eddie and appreciate you all giving me the chance to speak to your congregation tonight. I hope everybody had a wonderful Christmas. I know it's been a time of great joy for many of us, and I truly hope that was the case for many of you as well. However, unfortunately, as we know, sometimes we don't know what God has planned for us, and too often there are those among us who are coping with situations that make life more of a challenge. So if you don't mind, I'd like to just share two very quick stories with you. And Norma, I guess you're my wingman back there. Thank you. A number of years ago, when my husband and I were still living in New Jersey, we had an acquaintance who was caring for her elderly mother who'd gotten Alzheimer's. And at the time that happened, Dottie, our friend, was already in her 60s and was cleaning houses in order to make a living. Well, as her mother's health started to deteriorate, Dottie had to eventually give up her extra income to handle all the care that she needed to do for her mom. And unfortunately, over time, Dottie herself became more and more run down, more and more worn out, and sadly, she ended up passing on before her mother. It was awful. And I'm guessing that the toll of taking care of someone around the clock with no relief may have contributed to that. And in fact, a lot of statistics tell us today that too many caregivers do become overwhelmed and overworked, and too often their own health does give out before the care recipient. And sad to say, Dottie's story is not an isolated event. Just recently, I was working with another woman who's also being worn down and worn out because she's being caught in the middle. I'm going to call this woman Jane for now. Sorry, thank you. Jane's dad has Alzheimer's, and it's reached the point where he can't be alone. And he's fallen down a couple of times, and while the injuries haven't been that severe yet, Jane's mom is too frail to help lift and remove him. So too often, Jane, my coworker, had been leaving her job in Port Charlotte to run up the parish where her folks live, just so she could help out in emergencies. It's now reached the point where she's spending at least two nights a week in Paris staying with her folks before going to her job. When she finally gets back to her own home in Cape Coral, she's living with a husband who has his own disabilities, as well as her son and two of his children who moved in after the son got divorced. So she's trying to provide care at all ends. I saw that she went back to smoking, she's come down with at least two bouts of bronchitis, and now she's talking about having to give up her own job just in order to be available to care for everyone. These are the people the Jewish Family and Children's Services of the Suncoast, or JFCS, is trying to help. JFCS has been providing non-denominational programs, counseling, and social services to all those confronting life's challenges in our community since 1986. Tonight, the particular program I want to speak about through them is the AmeriCorps Legacy Respite Program. One back. Too quick. Backwards. One more. That's what it is. I'll wing it. That's the story of my life. I can wing it. I know you guys can. You can bear with me. No biggie. Thank you. All right, AmeriCorps, it's a part of their caregiver support service area, and it's a program that specifically provides respite to caregivers and companionship to their loved ones. Now, there may actually be some folks in this room who are already acting as the primary caregiver, and understand the challenges of trying to keep up with other aspects of your life. JFCS has recognized how important it is for the caregiver to maintain their emotional and physical health during this time. So with the help of a grant through... That's all right, we didn't rehearse it.
Back.
I'll just wing it. You'll just have to watch the show behind me and just Hope that somehow it catches up. JBS recognized how important it is for the caregiver to maintain that physical health. So with the help of AmeriCorps, they put together a program that matches volunteers with caregivers, offering them a much-needed 4-hour respite break each week. Now, what does respite care actually mean for our volunteers? It means they're there to sit with the care recipient, listen to their stories, engage them in conversation, just help maintain that human interaction that everyone needs. If anything should come up during that 4 hours, our volunteers are trained to use common sense, common grace to help resolve any situations. What our volunteers don't do, they don't act as home health care aides. We don't ask our volunteers to administer meds, we don't provide personal care to the care recipient, we don't transport them to doctors. We just make sure that we have somebody there who can stay with them, spend some quality time talking with them, maybe play games with them, share a hobby with them, just spend some meaningful time together. And by doing that, we're helping the family by providing the caregivers some time for their own needs too. In fact, some of our volunteers found this so rewarding, they've offered to work with 2 families a week, providing a total of 8 hours of respite care weekly. Now, AmeriCorps does require each volunteer to attend a 20-hour, one-week training program before they meet with the caregiver's family so that they can get acquainted, make sure everybody's comfortable with each other. And that 4-day training program usually covers what kind of resources are available in the area, how to handle challenging behaviors, how to set boundaries, and gives an overview of Alzheimer's and CPR basics. And then that training program is often followed by monthly mandatory training sessions with the volunteers, where they pick up even more techniques, and it's also a time for them to share their own thoughts, their own experiences and concerns with their fellow volunteers. Now, I know that sounds like a lot of commitment, and it is. So in order to help each of our volunteers offset the cost of that volunteering, this grant actually allows JFCS to pay a monthly stipend. We're still back, but it's $150 to each volunteer to help them with their travel costs as long as they complete their monthly service. And since we do have a real need for respite volunteers in Northport and South Sarasota County, we're trying our best to match our volunteers with local families right here. There's also another part of this program that I'd like to tell you about, and that's a chance to earn an educational award. If some volunteer would decide that they can spend 450 hours, that's during the course of the entire cycle, they can earn $1,468 that can be put towards any educational program at many of our local colleges, including in this area, USF, State College of Florida, Southwest Florida College, Edison College, Ringling School of Art Design, Sarasota County Technical Institute, and the Charlotte Technical Center. And there's even more good news about this educational award. You actually have 7 years to use it towards classes or loan payments, and if you can't use the award yourself, you can transfer it to your child, your grandchild, or your foster child, just as long as you're 55 and older. The only catch with the award is this year we have a shorter time frame, so you'd have to earn those 450 hours between February and October of next year. But if somebody in the room is interested in volunteering and getting that educational award, it can be done by working with just 3 families a week for a total of 12 respite hours. But even if you can't put in the 12 hours, even a 4-hour weekly commitment will earn you that $150 stipend. And by the way, all of these training sessions that I just mentioned earlier, they all go towards that $450 commitment. Now, is this type of volunteering good for everyone? Well, of course not. Some of us already have way too many commitments in our lives. And since each volunteer does have to go through a background check for criminal activities, sex offender status, and be fingerprinted, we know not everyone's going to feel comfortable doing that. But this program is also part of a goal to help veterans, so sometimes if we have somebody who's related to the military in some way, it could be service through yourself, service through your husband, through your wife, your child, your parent. Even in my own case, my dad served in World War II, so that would make me eligible to be a volunteer in this program, to either volunteer my time or get respite care. You don't have to have a military connection. They do have a percentage that will allow people who don't have the military to be a part of the program, but obviously it's been geared towards a lot of military families in our area. Now, 4 hours a week, that's our total that we're asking. Doesn't always sound like we're giving people a lot of time. But if that four-hour respite allows somebody to, and there's all my pictures up there, shop by themselves, visit a library, get their hair done, take a walk, or even just have lunch with a friend, we know we've taken a small step towards helping to make our world a better place by performing an act of loving kindness. Remember, the role of our volunteers is not to administer meds, we're not giving medical or legal advice, we don't change bandages, wash, bathe, or even lift the care recipient. The job of our volunteers is just to be a good audience for the care recipient, listen to their stories, be patient, be warm, friendly, and be another support service for the family by giving them someone they can rely on. They become the person who allows the caregiver a chance to recharge, rejuvenate, and relax for a few precious hours, knowing their loved one is in good and capable hands. So, is this program right for you? There's several ways it might be. If you're acting as a caregiver right now and would like to know more about how we can help offer you some respite relief, please stop by my table. I'll be in the back of the room after the service. And I'll be glad to see if JFCS can help make arrangements for some respite relief for you. Or could this program be right for someone else you know who's not here tonight? If you know someone who's struggling to provide care for a loved one and could use a break from time to time, again, please stop by my table. I'll be happy to give you a flyer with our caregiver helpline number on it. They could call that number, talk to one of the staff, and see if they can learn more about this free program and how it might be able to help their family. Or, if you belong to another group or organization that you think might want to hear more about this same program, again, please stop by my table. I'll be happy to get their contact information or even a name from you, and I'll be happy to follow up with them to see if they'd like to have me come speak to their group as well. Or, if you're willing and able to help someone yourself by spending at least 4 hours a week helping a family while you're in your stipend, and if you're interested, again, stop by and see me. I'll be glad to take your information and get in touch with you when we put our next training session together, which should be sometime in February. I know some of us already know how difficult and time-consuming it becomes to ensure our loved ones receive that special care every day, 24/7. JFCS also knows how important it is to keep the caregiver healthy in mind, body, and spirit. As one of only three sites offering this particular grant program in Florida, we want to let our families in the area know they have another support system they can rely on. If you can join us and be part of that system by giving these families just 4 hours a week of respite relief, you can help make a difference in their lives and help make our entire world a better place for all. I want to thank Eddie for giving me the opportunity to speak with you this evening. And if there are any questions, I'll be happy to answer them if you come back and see me at my table. And in the meantime, I want to thank everyone again for listening, and I wish all of you a new year filled with blessings, good health, and good fortune. Thank you.
Says my king is the king of the Jews. He's the king of Israel. He's the king of righteousness. He's the king of the ages. He's the king of heaven. He's the king of glory. He's the king of kings, and he's the Lord of lords. That's my king. I wonder, do you know him? My king is a sovereign king. No means of measure can define his limitless love. He's enduringly strong. He's entirely sincere. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperially powerful. He's impartially merciful. Do you know him? He's the greatest phenomenon that has ever crossed the horizon of this world. He's God's son. He's a sinner's savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He is the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's the fundamental doctrine of true theology. He's the only one qualified to be an all-sufficient savior. I wonder if you know him today. He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He strengthens and sustains. He guards and he guides. He heals the sick. He cleanses the leper. lepers. He forgives sinners. He discharges debtors. He delivers the captive. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. And he purifies the meek. I wonder if you know him. He's a key to knowledge. He's a wellspring of wisdom. He's a doorway of deliverance. He's a pathway of peace. He's a roadway of righteousness. He's a highway of holiness. He's a gateway of glory. Do you know him? Well, his light is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. And his yoke is easy. And his burden is light. I wish I could describe him to you. He's indescribable. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. Well, you can't get him out of your mind. You can't get him off of your hand. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Well, the Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him. Yeah!
All right, wasn't that awesome? Well, hello, New Hope. Let me do that one more time. Hello, New Hope.
Hello.
I want to welcome everyone, and especially our first-time guests who are with us here today. And I want our first-time guests to know how our community of faith here at New Hope is a place for imperfect people to belong, to grow, to serve, and to find healing and hope. And we endeavor to do that by loving Jesus, loving people, and serving our city and the world. Now, Americans have a love-hate relationship with kings. But our culture and our society craves thousand-year-old myths and legends centered around the return of a noble king who will rule his people with justice and usher in this wonderful era of prosperity. But our own American history is filled with these 13 little colonies that rebelled against their King George. And the world is filled with all kinds of examples of kings just like that. And so what that teaches us is that we're able to see how every human king has been absolutely appalling. And we've been able to see that because their record of tyranny and oppression and slavery and tragedy. And this is the reason why we have this love-hate relationship with kings. But let me tell you, there is a true king who has come and who is coming back again to end all tyranny, all oppression, all tragedy, all slavery, all sickness, all death, all hell and the grave. And I wonder if you know, because I want to introduce you to him tonight in a fresh and a wonderful way, I pray, for many of you. Before we do that, go any further and address that with the truth of the scriptures, let's pause and pray and invite the Holy Spirit to come to teach us what he would want us to learn through the ancient truths of the Bible. Amen?
Amen.
Let's bow our heads and pray. Father, Lord, we come and we stand before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are great and mighty. You are all-knowing and all-sufficient and all-powerful. And Lord, I have no idea why you are mindful of us. Who is man that the Almighty would be mindful of us? One little cosmic speck of dust called the planet Earth in comparison to the universe that you created. And Father, all of us are seeking ultimate happiness. But we use the good things in our life and we fill the places that were only meant for you to be in. And they were only meant for you to satisfy us. And so, Lord, we come here tonight and we ask you, Lord, help us and teach us your ways. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew. The verses as well will be on the screen. Starting with chapter 21, we'll be reading with verse 1. And it says, as they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, I tell him the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to the daughter of Zion, see your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, on a foal of a donkey. The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed, and they brought the donkey and the colt, placed their coats on them, and Jesus sat on them. And a very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowd that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest! When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, who is this? And the crowd answered, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. Jesus entered the temple and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. It is written, he said to them, my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers. The blind and the lame came to him at the temple and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things that he did and the children shouting in the temple area, Hosanna! Again, to the Son of David, they were indignant. Indignant means like they were really angry. Do you hear what these children are saying? They asked him. Yes, Jesus replied. Have you never read? You gotta say these are the Pharisees. They've memorized the whole scripture. Of course they've read it, but they're not understanding what they've read. From the lips of children and infants, you have ordained praise. And he left them and went out to the city of Bethany, where he spent the night. All right. What I want us to show here very clearly is how King Jesus comes to us like no other king in human history. Now, why do I say that? Well, if we look here in the passage, here are a couple of clues on his kingship. Verse 4 says, this took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophets. In other words, from the Old Testament. Okay? From the Old Testament, this prophecy came forth, talking about one day someone would come. And verse 5 clearly identifies who that someone would be. Say to the daughters of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt and a foal, and on a donkey. And if you jump down in verse 9, it says, the crowd that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David. And then again, it says that in verse 15, when he got into the temple area, that they cried out, Hosanna to the Son of David. Now, what does that mean? I mean, right now to you and me, as you know, modern day Americans, that means absolutely nothing. But to every Jewish man, woman, and child in that day, when someone was identified as the Son of David, in other words, that you were part of the lineage of David and his kingship, and the promise given to David and his whole household that he would be a king forever. And so, this is why the Pharisees and the teachers of the law were so angry. They were indignant because they said, how dare you say that? Because they knew that that title meant that it wasn't going to be just from the line of David, an ordinary king. What we see here clearly is that it was going to be someone greater. Someone greater is coming. But this king does not come like an ordinary king. Verse 5 says that this king comes to you gentle. Most kings don't come gentle. They come with power and might and an entourage, and they're flexing their everything that they have to impress you and show you that they're better and superior and such, but not this king. This king comes gentle. And he comes riding on a donkey. And matter of fact, Matthew here gives the implication that this donkey has been unridden. Okay, now I'm not a farm boy. I was born and raised in Brooklyn, and so I'm a city boy, and I don't really know much about riding donkeys and farming and anything like that. You know, so, but I've been told by, you know, good old West Virginian boys who grew up on a farm in the mountains and such, that you can't ride a donkey that's not broke. I mean, you just don't do that. And most kings who come in a triumphal entry into their capital city comes on one of the most powerful war horses you could ever think of. They don't come straddling an unbroken donkey. And then in a massive crowd, everybody's screaming. Which just shows the fact that Jesus came gentle and humble, and that the donkey knew who his master was. Amen. That brought great peace and comfort. And that in the midst of the wildness of a wild donkey, the king has power to bring peace and joy and serenity. I love the fact that the end of verse 9 says, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," and it says comes. And really the implication here, this word come has a present and future tense to it. There's a present tense and a future tense. So not only does this king come gentle, but he's right here, right now. And he's also coming. Just an amazing prophetic prophecy that was spoken. I love the way that we see another quality of this king. This king doesn't come trying to appease the crowd. Matter of fact, when he's confronted by the Pharisees and the Sadducees, he goes, yeah. I mean, he knows. This is the first time in all of the Gospels that you're going to see where Jesus actually accepts the praise and the worship of others. And every Jewish man, woman, and child, especially the Pharisees and Sadducees, knew that he was declaring himself to be the one greater than the king, the Lord of the Lord David, the one to come. What I want to do is I want to spend some time looking at that. We're going to go to the Old Testament. I just want you to see from the New Testament the proclamation of Jesus and who they're talking about. So when we get to the Old Testament and see it, we know specifically where this thing is going. So turn with me to Psalms chapter 2. And this psalm is just a wonderful psalm because it really, it's what they call a prophetic, messianic call to the future king to come. And as we read it, it'll hopefully make sense. Psalm chapter 2, verse 1 says, "Why do the nations conspire and the people plot in vain? The kings of the earth take their stand and the rulers gather together against the Lord and against his anointed one. Let us break their chains, they say, and throw off their fetters. The one enthroned in heaven laughs. The Lord scoffs at them. Then he rebukes them in his anger and terrifies them in his wrath, saying, I have installed my king, on Zion, on my holy hill. I will proclaim the decree of the Lord. He said of me, you are my son. Today I have become your father. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your inheritance, the end of the earth your possessions. You will rule them with an iron scepter. You will dash them to pieces like pottery. Therefore, you kings, be wise. Be warned, you rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoicing with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry and you be destroyed in your ways. For his wrath can flare up in a moment. Blessed are all who take refuge in him." Okay. Almost every human kingdom has been toppled. And in its place has sprouted up some kind of democracy over the world. Now, democracy is good because human beings are so corrupt and so self-absorbed that we're not fit to rule. Amen. And so democracy is more of a medicine than food. We can't live on medicine. But the Bible clearly shows you and me that our heart, our soul, and our very being craves a true king. Because even if we were to reject the king, every single one of us in this room naturally would create our own king. Like, we would begin to form a time that we would create someone that we would put high and above, and we would lift them up like human celebrities, or some like athletes, or billionaires, or artists, some even gangsters, or some moral or religious philosophical code, and all of these that we religiously follow. And we give our time and our talents and our treasures to, because they make us happy. And this is the textbook definition of worshiping. When we look at all the athletes, or we look at all the people that we go, we spend money buying their records and their t-shirts and their you know, we dress like them, we change our hair, we buy their makeup. I mean, you know, the more they can put their stuff in, basically we're their fan club. The textbook definition of worship. Because you and I, our hearts are craving for a king. The problem is that our hearts have always been craving for the true king. So as we continue to examine today's scriptures, let us explore why love came down to rule the world. Because the Bible teaches us that Jesus, as the true King, becomes our greatest and ultimate reward. And I believe this is best understood when you and I realize that there is no refuge from the King, only in the King. I want you to just take a moment and let that ponder for a second. There is no refuge for you and I from the King, only a refuge in the King. And what I believe this shows us is in Jesus as our true King, we find infinite majesty, yet complete humility, perfect justice, yet boundless grace, absolute sovereignty, yet utter submission. So how and why is this so important for us to know? Because how you and I treat Jesus as King exposes two things about the condition of our heart. Either our heart will be full of sin, or our heart will be full of salvation. And the simple illustration of that is sin is the servant placing himself in the position of the king. Which, on the other hand, salvation is the king who has placed himself in the position of a servant. And there is only one true king that has ever come in all of human history that has ever done that for you and for me. And that's the King that I pray that you and I will spend our time learning and growing and putting our trust in. What I want to do is I want to pull out four things here. Four things out of Psalms chapter 2 that I believe reflects how you and I will treat our true king. Verse 1, Psalm 2 says, why do the nations conspire? The end of verse 2, it says, against the Lord and against His anointed one. And what I want to suggest to you that this issue is that there is this natural love and hate relationship that every single one of us have on the planet. I don't think it's just to us as Americans. But it's against the Lord, and it says here, against His anointed one. Literally, that word translates in Hebrew, okay, as Messiah, which literally means the fact that this is the one who is supposed to come, all right, literally meaning God Himself. This is what all the Old Testament way, the anointed one. In Greek, it's pronounced Christ. Okay, Jesus Christ, Christ is His last name. Okay. Christ means anointed one. And so, from the Old Testament to the New Testament, there has been one king, one true king, that God has promised, that He said here in verse 6, I will install my king, and that king has come to destroy and end tyranny and oppression and death and hell and sickness and sorrow and tears. He's going to wipe it all away. But He doesn't come like the kings of humanity. He comes gentle. He comes and He challenges and He confronts. See, as we read in Matthew, He confronted the money changers. He confronted those who actually considered and thinking about, would you accept me as your king or not? Matter of fact, what I want to suggest to you today is that I know that many of us say, well, Eddie, come on, you know, this Jesus thing, come on, you're taking this thing a little bit too serious. You know, we don't hate any king, or you know, we have nothing against God. And I've heard this argument so much in New York. And I used to love sitting there and having this great discussion. And on a surfacey level, I would agree to say that the average person doesn't hate the concept of God. The average person doesn't even hate the concept of a God. But what we've seen throughout all of human history is that they hate the God of the Bible, who confronts them and says, be holy as I am holy. That if you're going to follow me, that you're going to have to carry your cross. Amen. That you're no longer going to understand that you are your own, but that you have been purchased by Christ. And so like Jesus in His day, the Pharisees and the Sadducees came against Him. And all those in the temple who wanted, eventually we knew what happened, they crucified Him. This is what I want you to appreciate. Those who were screaming, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. It's how fickle a crowd is. Was not soon after saying, crucify. And I want to say to you and to me that our King, who comes gentle as a lamb, confronts us philosophically, emotionally, cognitively, and He says, you will either have me as your king or kill me. I will have nothing in between. I am your Savior. I am your Redeemer. I am not your water boy. I am not your consultant. That when you need a little jack in the box, you're just going to wind me up, pop me out, here I am, and then when you don't even know, you put me back, and there I go. That's the God of the Bible said, that's not me. And that's the one that the world looks at and goes, oh, wait a minute. I mean, you believe that? I mean, that's so primitive. To believe such a thing, really? Read the book. Come to your own conclusions. The nations conspire, kings of the earth take their stand. I love verse 3. It really gives the idea of what, how we do this. It says, let us break their chains, they say, and throw off their fetters. Now, this word fetters can also be translated yoke. Okay? Can also be translated yoke. An oxen, oxes have yokes, horses have harnesses and fetters. Depending on what terminology you're going to use or how you look at that word, it can be either or. But I want you to understand that they're talking about the kings of the earth. Verse 2, talking about throwing off their yokes. And this is why it's so amazing, the Word of God. The Word of God shows us that the kings of the earth, and the reason why they're conspiring and they're against His anointed one and such, and they're trying to throw off His yoke. If you're an ox and you have a yoke, that means you have a master who's greater than you. There is a king behind the king who is greater. There is a Lord behind the Lord, a King of kings and a Lord of lords over all the kings and all the princes and all the presidents and all the premiers in the world. Amen. And humanity, since its beginning, has been trying to throw off the yoke, thinking that they'll be better off. And realizing that all they're doing is hurting themselves. People are not hostile against the idea of God or the concept of God. They're just hostile against the God of the Bible, who tells them to be holy as I am holy. Can we submit ourselves to the King of Kings and know that He has the best plan for your life and my life? That even in the midst of the most difficult times and scenarios, see, most of us are saying, well, yeah, I'll serve God as long as it goes my way. I mean, as long as I get that job, as long as I get that career, and as long as I get these things, then I'll be faithful, then I'll be whatever, and then you've got the jack-in-the-box God. That's not the God of the Bible. Everybody loves the concept of God as being, He's my cabana boy. Go run and get me something. God will not be mocked. He will be king or He will be nothing. And the reason, and let me just say, it's not because He's arrogant and not because He just wants to feel so superior over me. The reason is that you and I don't understand our condition. We don't understand our condition and why we continue to try to throw off the yoke. Verse 8 says, ask of me. In other words, rely on me. Rely on me on what? When you and I are in pain and in misery and in sorrow, when we're in great need, when our circumstances, when we're financially bankrupt, when they come to take our house, if we get a terrible diagnosis from a doctor, if something tragic happens, someone gets hurt, whatever, yes, God, please come, rescue me. And that right there is probably superficially where we all at. Every single human being on the planet. But what you and I don't realize in our human condition is because we are so corrupt and self-absorbed that soon after God comes and delivers us out of His mercy, out of His grace, out of because He has chosen to pour out His affections upon you and come and die on a cross and show you His great love while you never haven't earned it at all. No sooner than He's done that, you and I then naturally will create another king that will serve us. Job, career, house, mortgage, vacations, friends, whatever it may be. I have no idea what it'll be for you. But something else will come in. And it'll, I'm not saying those are not bad things. That's the danger. Those are good things. And we take those good things and we put them in the place that they were never meant to be. And only God was meant to be there. He was meant to be our king. And what ends up happening is that we try to find satisfaction somewhere in this life. And our condition is that there is nothing in this life that was ever meant to fully satisfy you but Him. He's not Savior, He's Savior and Lord. He's Savior and King. And we spend a lifetime growing in the knowledge of the fact that our King, your King, my King, is the true King who has come. And He has come to redeem and save and set you and me free. And we come to Him because we need rescue, even from our very selves. And that's why we gather. And that's why we study and pray. And that's why we go through many of the disciplines. Not because we want to earn God or, hopefully He'll love me more. He can't love you any more than He does already. Amen. It's because we're going to spend all of time and all of eternity growing and knowing this great God who is infinite in majesty yet completely humble, who is perfect in His justice. And I hope you know and get to know who that King is. Lastly, in verse 12, the end of verse 12, it says, blessed are all who take refuge in Him. Blessed. I want to just suggest to us that probably one of the main reasons for me in my own personal life why I resisted God for a long, long, long time was that my expectations for God were so small. My God, in my own eyes, was so small. My circumstances were larger than the God that I serve. And then when I began to understand that He is the King of kings and Lord of lords, and He created the heavens and the earth and the universe and all that's in it, and I realized that my little circumstance was small in comparison to the greatness of the God of the universe, who has all power, all knowing, and all ability to speak, and all creation comes into existence. And He can't help me with my finances. He can't come and help me work out and heal a relationship, restore a marriage. Of course He can. But my expectations are so small. See, this is the thing about coming to the King, relying on Him, submitting to Him, yielding to Him. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in Him. Every time, it's a promise. I love the way Chick started. He said, you know, Daddy, He wants us to run to Him with our hands up high. See, this is what my sons knew when they were little. They came to me with every single problem because they had the expectation that Daddy was going to give them the answer, and Daddy was going to make sure that what they needed they had. It was never an issue that they didn't think that I wasn't going to feed them, I was going to take care of them, I was going to take them. It was never an issue. So I wonder, is our expectation hindering us? Really being connected to God. And I tell you, He does it, and He provided for us a wonderful opportunity in the Lord's Supper, communion, to remember that He has promised to provide for all of our needs according to His riches and glory. Not because you and I earned it or deserved it. I'm going to tell you what my sons earned. Squat Dylan. Absolutely nothing. I love those boys the first day I saw them. I love them till I have my last breath. I love them into eternity. And all they did was tick, 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 tick. Different than us. So to think that you're going to go to your daddy in heaven and you're going to earn it, and you sit there going, how could my son earn my love? How could he? I mean, if you just thought about it logically, it makes no sense. Father in heaven loves you and me, and He wants to pour out His blessings. Will you take refuge in Him? Or will you continue to think that you're the master of your own destiny? The true King has come. He is great. He is worthy of our time, worthy of our efforts, worthy of our worship. And I want to close our time with a time of worship to our great King. And I want to offer us an opportunity to respond and take refuge. The beautiful thing about him is to remember what he did for us on the cross. That he died for us, his body was broken, his blood was shed. That you and I, who owed a great debt, would now be free. This is one of the beautiful pictures of communion. That you and I can take refuge in him. This has nothing to do with denomination. This has nothing to do with, you know, tradition you come from. If you want to take refuge in the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, then all it takes is a yielding heart to God. And to begin that journey. The journey doesn't end here. It begins here. So let's all stand. As the song is being played, if you feel in your heart and desire, so okay, I want to take refuge in the arms of my King, and I invite you to come forward and take communion. And while the song is being played, just feel free to come out of your seats, hold the elements, and then I'll come and close in prayer. But right now, if you say, listen, Eddie, I don't know, I'm not ready here, I'm in this God thing, it's kind of interesting, I'm not sure. Listen, it's okay. We love you. Don't feel any obligation to come forward. No one's going to think bad of you or anything like that. But I wouldn't want this to be a dead, meaningless ritual for you to come up here and see everybody else. But to come because you want to take refuge in the King. And not because you're here, because you want to run to him and say, here I am, and your expectation is your daddy stretching out his hands to you. Let's play this song, and then feel free to come up.
He is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us. Oh, oh, how he loves us. How he loves us all. Oh. For me, love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how are for me. Oh, how he loves, yeah, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. loves us, how he loves us all.
Trying to be the master of our own destiny or salvation? Will we run to him, let him be our refuge, allow the king to place himself in the place of a servant to give his life for you and for me simply because he loves us? And we do this in remembrance of what he did for us, his body broken and his blood shed for us. Let's take his body and blood together. Father, I thank you, Lord, for every single person here. I pray, Lord, that we would grow in knowing how much you love us. That you are our God, our King, our Redeemer, our Savior. And Lord, that changes everything. That you came to end tyranny and oppression and tragedy and slavery and bondage and sickness and death. And we come and we run to you and have a great expectation, Lord, that you're able to do what you promised. And so we stand on your promise. We stand on your word. Lord, may we never be the same. We thank you, bless you, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful evening.